श्री राजीव गोस्वामी, श्री सनातन, श्री रूप एंड श्री वल्लभ वर थ्री ब्रदर्स ऑल एम्प्लॉयड इन द सर्विस ऑफ द बादशाह हुसैन शाह. एमंग्स द थ्री देर वॉज ओनली वन डिसेंडेंट श्री जीव हैविंग बीन रिवार्डेड रिचली बाय द बादशाह फॉर देयर सर्विसेस. देयर हाउस होल्ड लाइफ वॉज वेरी ऑपुलेंट. देर वॉज नथिंग लैकिंग इन व्हाट एवर वॉज नेसेसरी फॉर द अपब्रिंगिंग ऑफ द ओनली सन. The house was illuminated by the effulgence of the child's golden complexion. His eyes were like the expanded petals of the lotus. Every part of his body was graced with a lustrous, radiant splendor. When Sri Gaurisundar came to Ramkeli, Sri Jeev was blessed by having darshan of his worshipable Lord. Though he was just a baby at the time, placing the dust of his lotus feet on the child's head, Mahaprabhu indicated him to be in the future sovereign preceptor of the Gaudiya Sampradaya. Though he was only a child, Sri Jeev kept the form of the Lord, which fascinates all the world, within his heart. As he grew up, while eating, lying down, in his dreams, while he was awake, at all times he would meditate on that form. Later on, when his father and uncles renounced their family life in order to be with Mahaprabhu, the only child Sri Jeev was left with his mother in the family placed at Fatiabad. Lying in her lap, which was wet with tears of separation, he gradually began to grow as the waxing moon. Seeing that the mother and the child's face were always wet with tears, their friends also fell under the shadow of sadness and only with great difficulty managed to assuage their grief. Whenever Sri Jeev would remember his father and uncles or the lotus feet of Sri Gaur Hari, he would lose consciousness and fell to the ground. As he got a little older, Sri Jeev took up the worship of the deities of Sri Sri Ramakrishna. He would carefully decorate them and offer bhog and aarti, serving them with his full attention. Even in his play, whatever games he played were connected with Sri Krishna's pastimes. While studying under the local pandit, he became proficient in grammar, poetry, and rithi. Nothing is great intellect, his teachers commented, such a brilliance is not often found in a child so young as this. No doubt he will be a very high-souled, saintly person. Even while engaged in his studies, Jeev always thought of Sri Sri Nitai Gaurisundar. When he saw in a dream that Sri Ramakrishna had taken the form of Nitai Gauranga and were dancing, Bhakti Ratnakar 1.732, giving him the dust of their lotus feet, the two lords then disappeared. Having seen such a wonderful dream, Sri Jeev was consulted somewhat. Then he began to think, when I'll be able to crawl out of this well of family life and devote my full time and energy, my very self, to serving these two most magnanimous lords. But he was the only son of the family. Only in his company cloud his mother forget somewhat the pangs of separation in her heart. When Sri Jeev learned that his father had given up his life on the banks of the Ganga, he is completely unsettled. After that, his eyes were never dry. The family members and friends tried to console him, but to little avail. Family life had become the source of his utter sadness. Someone suggested to Jeev to go to Navadvip and bathe himself in the coolness emanating from the lotus feet of Lord Nityananda Prabhu, so that his mind and body burning with his grief will be refreshed. The Sri Jeev set out for Navadvip with a group of pilgrims, Bhakti Ratnakar 1.741. Nityananda Prabhu, the omniscient Lord, could understand that Sri Jeev was on his way to Navadvip. Therefore, he also left for there from Khardaha. After a few days, Jeev arrived at Navadvip. Seeing the beauty of that place, he was charmed. Falling down on the ground, he offered his dandavat through Mother Ganges. Inquiring from the villagers the direction to Mayapur, he learned that Nityananda Prabhu was residing at Srivas Pandit's house. At last arriving there, he fell down at the door to after his dandavat. Nityananda Prabhu came out with Srivas Pandit and picked him up and embraced him, asking, "Are you the nephew of Sri Rupa and Sri Sanatan?" As an answer, Jeev again fell down on the ground at the lotus feet of Nityananda Prabhu. This time Nityananda Prabhu brought him in the house and began to inquire after the welfare of his family at Fatihabad. Then Sri Jeev was introduced to the devotees present in Navadvip. He offered his salutations at their lotus feet. Everyone was very happy to meet the nephew of Sri Rupa and Sanatan. That day Sri Jeev received the remnants of Nityananda Prabhu's prasadam. The next day, the two of them came to Sachi Mata's house. Seeing the birthplace of Sri Gaurisundar, which was filled with such splendors, Sri Jeev was greatly pacified and fell down on the ground to roll in the dust. In the large courtyard, the devotees were singing songs praising the glories of Sri Krishna Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, seeing Nityananda Prabhu. Everyone stood up and then fell down, offering their dandavats at his lotus feet. Then Jeev saw Sachi Mata sitting on the veranda, dressed in white with silk chadar around her shoulders. She looked radiant, the white of her hair blending with her white sari, though her body trembled with old age and was very thin. Still, the courtyard was illuminated by her divine effulgence. Forgetting herself in remembrance of Sri Gaurisundar, she was sitting with her eyes closed. Becoming aware that Nityananda Prabhu had arrived, she covered her head with her sari and called her servant, Ishan. Sripad has arrived, please wash his feet. After this was done, Nityananda offered namaskar to the mother of the Supreme Lord and took his seat. He then introduced Sri Jeev to her. Sachi Mata placed her hand on his head to bless him, and Sri Jeev floats in the ocean of happiness. Sachi Mata then requested the two of them to honor the Lord's prasad. "Take prasad here at your mother's house today, my child. I offered their preparation in secret to Sri Gaurichandra." Sri Jeev spent some days with Nityananda Prabhu touring the nine islands of Navadvip in order to have darshan of the holy places of the Lord's first times there. Then, as ordered by Nityananda Prabhu, he set out for Kashi, Varanasi. At Kashi, he studied Vedanta under Sri Madhusudan Vachaspati, a disciple of Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya. The conclusions of Vedanta contained in Srimad Bhagavatam that were expounded by Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu to Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya in Puri had been in turn taught by the Bhattacharya to Madhusudan Vachaspati, who established a toll at Kashi. From him, Sri Jeev mastered the same conclusions. From here, Sri Jeev set out for Sri Vrindavan, where he received shelter at the lotus feet of his two uncles, Sri Rupa and Sanatan. They were very pleased to see him and received from him all the news. Jeev stayed with Sri Rupa, who began to teach him Srimad Bhagavatam. After initiating him with the divine mantra, Rupa engaged him in the service of Sri Radha Damodar. According to Sadhan Deepika, this deity of Damodar was fashioned by Rupa Goswami's own hand for his dear disciple Sri Jeev Goswami. Sri Radha Damodar were presently being worshipped in Jaipur, Rajasthan. Seeing that Jeev had quickly become conversant with the conclusion of the Srimad Bhagavatam, Sri Rupa engaged him in proof reading as Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu. At this time, Sri Jeev compiled a commentary on Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu called Durgam Sangamani. In the year 1476 Sakabda, Sri Sanatana Goswami compiled Sri Vaishnava Tosani, a commentary on the 10th canto of Srimad Bhagavatam, which he gave to Sri Jeev for proof reading. Under the order of Sri Sanatan, Sri Jeev compiled a commentary on that named Laghu Vaishnav Tosani in the year 15th Sakabda. His writings, along with those of Sri Rupa and Sri Sanatan, Sri Gopal Bhatta, Sri Raghunath Bhatta, Sri Raghunath Das, Sri Krishna Das, Sri Kasishwar Pandit and Sri Madhu Pandit completely captivated the learned men of that time. It was the beginning of a golden age at Sri Brajadham. Sri Jeev regularly brought water for Sri Rup and Sanatan's bath. He massaged their heads with oil, cleaned their ashram, worshipped the deity, cooked and corrected manuscripts. After the disappearance of Sri Rup and Sanatan, Sri Jeev continued to tradition that they had inherited. Once Sri Jeev traveled to Agra to debate with the Rajputs concerning the glories of Jamuna and Ganga rivers. He established that the Jamuna is more glorious than the Ganga, as the Ganga emanates from Krishna's lotus feet, whereas the Jamuna is his own concern. At this, the Mughal Empire was very much satisfied and wanted to present his something. Sri Jeev replied that he would accept some blank papers. So the emperor presented Jeev some stamped paper. At that time, paper was very rare and most manuscripts were usually composed on leaves. There is also a legend that once, when a Mughal Empire, possibly Akbar, wanted to confer something on the Goswami of Vrindavan, they requested a Herman Emperor's order that no living beings will be killed within Braja. As a result of this, no king will come to hunt there anymore. This disciple of Loknath Goswami, Narottam Das Thakur Mahasai, Sri Gopal Bhatta Goswami's disciple Srinivas Acharya Prabhu, and the disciple of Hriday Chaitanya Prabhu Sri Shyamananda Prabhu were greatly favored by Sri Jeev Goswami. Under his tutelage, they studied all the literatures of the Goswamis. Later, he sent them to preach this knowledge in Bengal. Srila Jeev Goswami composed many literature, amongst them Harinam Chintamani Vyakaran, Sutra Mallika, Rasamrit Sesa, Gopal Virudavali, Sri Madhav Mahotsav, Sri Sankalpa Kalpa Vriksha, Brahma Sanghita Tika, Bhakti Rasam Sindhu Tika, Durgam Sangamani, Ujjal Nilmali Tika, Lochan Lochani, Gopal Champu, Sat Sandarbha, Tatta Sandarbha, Bhagavat Sandarbha, Paramatma Sandarbha, Krishna Sandarbha, Bhakti Sandarbha, Priti Sandarbha, Srimad Bhagavat Tika, Karma Sandarbha, Laghu Vaishnav Tosani, 10th Canto Bhagavatam Commentary, Sarva Sambandha Sambandhina Commentary on Sat Sandarbha, Gopal Tapani Tika, Sri Sukh Bodhini, Padma Purnashta Jogasara Istotra Tika, Gayatri Vyakhya Vibriti, a commentary on the Gayatri Mantras, as described in the Agni Puran, chapters 216 and 217, Radha Krishna Charan Chandrika, Dhatu Sangraha, Bhavartha Sochuk Champu, birth 1533 Christian calendar, 1455 Sakabda, first 12th day of the bright fortnight in the month of Bhadra, disappearance 1540 Sakabda, third day of bright fortnight Posa, aged 85 years. All glories to Srila Jeev Goswami Ki Jai. All glories to Guru and Gauranga. All glories to Srila Prabhupada. Hare Krishna. Shama, Shama.